And I was talking last night about the rules of engagement, about being in warfare. There's a few things that we have to know. One of the things that we have to know is you have to be clear about which side you're on.
All right, come on.
Now, I'm just going to take my time. I'm not going to preach. We got hooped and hollered last night, so I'm going to take my time.
Yes.
I want somebody to get James chapter 4, verse 7 for me.
I have that.
Read that for me.
So then submit yourselves to God.
Because if you are called to be a soldier in the army of the Lord, your will is not your own. Your assignment is not your own. What you've been called to do is not about you. Because of this, go 4 and 7.
Yes. So then submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
So as you are commissioned to be a warrior in the war, in the army of the Lord, the first thing you need to do, see, they have this thing. My brother-in-law was in the army, and before they issued him his M16 and his boots and his rank of petty officer, he went through this thing called boot camp.
Yeah.
And boot camp is where they tear you down.
Amen.
They take everything that's about you away from you.
Yes.
They tell you, like he was saying last night, I'm your mama. The army's your mama. The army's your daddy. You used to date a beauty queen. Now you date your M16.
Yes.
You used to ride a Cadillac. Now you got a backpack on your back.
Right.
They're taking away your personal identity so that you can be a good soldier in the army.
Yeah.
It's necessary as we begin our warfare, or as we battle in the army of the Lord, that we make sure that every part of us belongs to Jesus.
Yes.
Say, every part of us belongs
every
to Jesus.
Part.
Because let me tell you what happens if every part of you don't belong to Jesus. The enemy has something to shoot at. If there's any part of you, you know, I saw one of my favorite movies is a movie called A Few Good Men.
Yes.
And there were these officers. Now, they were just officers by rank, not by experience. They had never been in warfare. And they thought it was wonderful to put on their white officer's uniform while going into the battleground. And one of the grunt soldiers said, "You've obviously never been in battle." And the officer said, "Why do you say that?" He said, "Because only somebody that's never been in battle will come into an open war zone wearing your white officer's uniform. Because that's so easy to see from miles away at a sniper.
Yeah.
You are a sitting target."
Amen.
You know, the Lord wants us to know that before you even start warring against the enemy, make sure that your coat, your hat, your shoes, your boots is dipped in the blood of Jesus. That your mind, your spirit, your mouth, your tongue is dipped in the blood of Jesus. Your heart, your walk, your talk, your eyes are dipped in the blood of Jesus. So that when you stand on the battle of warfare, you can stand in power and authority. And the enemy has no place against you. Let me tell you something. Rank don't make you a good soldier.
Come on.
No, it
doesn't. Thank you,
Lord.
The enemy has no respect of person. He don't care if you a pastor. He don't care if you a minister. He don't care if you got cards, if you an evangelist, if you've been saved and on the battlefield for 45 years. He's looking at something to shoot at. And if he has a small target. The Bible says we carry above all things the shield of faith. Therefore, we quench the fiery darts of the enemy. That's telling you the schemes of the devil. He's telling you. He's sitting back and looking for a target. And you know what I learned about the devil? He's patient. Satan is patient. He'll wait. Oh, he'll wait. Because he knows your buttons. And he'll just speak a little something to try to get you off the mark. And he'll just push. And some person will come and say just that thing that you needed said.
Uh-huh.
You know, the enemy know that thing that you needed said.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. And all he wants to do is just push you off the mark so he can have a target to shoot at. But the Lord says, submit yourself unto God. And the second part of James 4:7 says, then resist the devil. Now, I talked last night, and so did the preacher, about resistance.
Yeah.
About pressing against the force that's coming against you. And you know, something I've learned about hand-to-hand combat is, and Muhammad Ali said this, he said, the battle is won far before you're in front of everybody in the lights. The battle is won on the road, when you're running the miles, in the gym, when you're rehearsing, when you shadow boxing, when you're fighting, when nobody's looking. And in the same way, the spiritual battle is not won in front of everybody on Sunday at church. It's won in your private time, in your secret place, in your closet. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds and bringing into captivity every thought against the obedience of Jesus Christ, and bringing down every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Well, our warfare is prayer and fasting. Our warfare is surrender and submission. Submit yourself unto God. Our warfare is yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something that'll make the enemy flee. Yes, Lord. From the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul, shine a light on me, Jesus. For righteousness is a breastplate that protects me. Somebody go to to Judges chapter 6. Now I'm going to preach a little bit.
Yeah, you're preaching good. I'm loving it.
Hallelujah. We find the children of Israel in a very familiar place. In Judges chapter 6, a place of disobedience.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Foolish Israel. Foolish Israel.
Yes.
Start on verse 1.
The Israelites did what was evil in the sight of the Lord.
Oh my God. The Israelites did what is evil in the sight of the Lord.
Yes.
Now let me tell you where Israel was in this place in history. Yes. Israel had just been brought out of Egypt.
Yes.
They had been in captivity for hundreds and hundreds of years. And they were in bondage and slavery. And they were under servitude. They were under the taskmaster, as we were in sin. When sin did have its hand over us, and we were slaves to sin. So Israel were slaves to Egypt, and they toiled under the taskmaster. They worked for hundreds of years, and they sowed and didn't reap. Do you know what slavery is? Slavery is working for free. You know, in this country, African American people, our people, were slaves for 436 years. And they called us all kinds of names, dehumanized our people. They did degradation and evil, but they didn't do it because they hated us. They did it so they could put us in a place to keep us in bondage and servitude, because they was making money on us. Egypt kept Israel under their feet because they wanted to take the spoil. As a matter of fact, it was the Israelites that made Egypt the greatest and most wealthy nation in the world at that time. The reason the enemy is coming against you is because he sees the potential and the purpose of God in you. And he wants to take that purpose and potential and use it for his glory. He wants to take your wealth and your power and your glory and your anointing and your giftings, and he wants to turn it around and use it for his kingdom. He's not fighting you for nothing. You are not in warfare for nothing. You are valuable. You are powerful. You are mighty. You are anointed. You are made in God's image. You have something great within you. It's worth something. It's valuable. And sometimes we don't fight because the enemy sees our purpose and potential more than we see our purpose and potential. He's busy fighting us, and we crying and having a pity party. And here is where we find Israel. They did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And read.
The Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian.
And because they were disobedient, because they did not submit themselves unto God, their enemy was given power over them.
Yes.
Come on now.
I found something out. If you are in disobedience, the enemy will have power over you. But the moment you step